The FBI is looking into Catherine's case. And right now, the way it looks is they're going to be pursuing charges against all of you. I know you don't love me, but you don't have to be so mean. Everybody is blaming this on Joy, but the reality is that once we started looking into things, things just started popping up out of the woodwork. We started finding out information about people, hearing about things that people saw, things that people said, things that people did. All these things that we were hearing were backed up by fact.
Joy was barely a teenager when she remembers watching another young girl forced into what her mom called a punishment bath, a steel tub filled with abrasive chemicals.
I remember hearing her scream. I remember dressing her wounds. I was made to help.
She was heard from that closet, scratching on the wall. I mean, that's horrific.
We were down there several times as an agency to investigate different child abuse cases.
It wasn't just children that got beat. Adults got beat, too, just as equally.
He pulled his shirt off, and it was just shredded.
It's confusing, contradictory, and a little eerie to see the house where 75-year-old Anna Elizabeth Young has lived. The place where she hid from police behind signs depicting her love of Jesus. More than 20 of them grab your attention as you walk to her front door. It almost feels like overcompensating.
Yeah, she was even let out of the closet by one of the children, and then once stepmother found out, put her right back in.
Neighbors can't believe their quiet, elderly neighbor had a secret so dark.
They kept those kids so well guarded, you very rarely saw them. Although they carried Bibles around, I said, they're not practicing what they were preaching, you know. Something's amiss here. Something's wrong. Something's really wrong.
They were sitting in a car with another couple drinking and laughing, and that doesn't sound like a distraught parent to me, especially on the very first night that your child's gone missing.
We could compel you to testify. We could deliver a subpoena and order you to testify, either before at our state attorney's office or at the U.S. attorney's office or at a federal grand jury. We prefer to do it like this.
Deputies say she tortured and killed a toddler. She burned a 12-year-old girl in a chemical bath to get the demons out of her.
I talked to one guy. He said, I got to get out of here. I got to get out of here. I got to get out of here.
The man said this is where his sister was killed and where they suffered torturous abuse.
They got this oven going 24 hours a day. My instinct said they're putting bodies in there.
We believe that body was disposed of in a fire. We believe there are numerous victims, not just one.
So this child, Moses, that was tortured, murdered at the scene, and burned in a burn barrel at the scene in Micanopy.
She's living down the street from me, and it's horrifying, really. I just don't know where you can get that mindset to even do that to a child.
Police say Young is a former cult leader who ran a religious boarding school in Florida. The children called her Mother Anna.
I know you don't love me, but you don't have to be so mean. I know you don't love me, but you don't have to be so mean.
She was quite abusive to the non-biological children, and her own children were treated very well. Some of the kids that I've talked to couldn't wait to get out of the house when they turned 18.
He said there was an 18-wheeler trailer over there, and he said it would keep us chained up in there for days, sometimes weeks.
I kept thinking, my God, was she like in that closet all week? How long was this poor girl in that closet, and how much did these kids see and are not admitting?
Kids had to have seen a lot more than what they're telling. If people are trying to direct you off in different directions, it kind of sends up a red flag on that, especially if they're not being very cooperative.
She may look like a good person, or she may talk as if she's a God-fearing person, but don't let that fool you.
Can you just tell us where she is? We can recover her, give her the proper burial that she deserves.
I know you don't love me, but you don't have to be so mean.
The following episodes include some offensive and dated words read from police reports and newspapers circa the 1970s. This season also deals with child abuse, so listener discretion is advised. Nature can be as unforgiving as a cynical heart. Perhaps because the Warren Dunes had claimed so many souls already, that set the stage for how the tragedy months later would be perceived. On January 1st, 1973, As Richard and Eileen Doolin and their five children visited its icy shores on New Year's Day, 10-year-old Jennifer walked about 2 feet from the edge of the pile of broken lake ice that had been deposited onto the shore like piles of broken concrete shoved into a mound by a tractor at a construction site. Suddenly, the ground cracked beneath her. Her mother had already jumped in after the girl as another visitor turned around to witness the father running toward the edge. "Don't!" the man yelled. He tossed his keys to a friend and yelled for her to get the police as he ran toward the family's other four children. All three, father, son, and daughter, perished in the frigid water of Lake Michigan, despite onlookers tossing in ropes that none of the victims could hold onto for long enough to be pulled to safety over that 6 feet of accumulated ice at the water's edge. The surviving children saw everything, and I can't imagine how difficult their lives have been after bearing witness to such a catastrophic event while being completely helpless to do anything as their family members perished.
The FBI is looking into Catherine's case. And right now, the way it looks is they're going to be pursuing charges against all of you. That's why they came down and they interviewed your mom and tried to give her an opportunity to save you guys the trouble. And she, for whatever reason, has chosen to let you guys sink the ship.
Nine months later, another family headed to the Warren Dunes State Park from the Chicago area. Three cars filled with three adults and seven kids, ranging from 6 to 18 years old, made that 77-mile, hour and 20-minute journey, past Indiana Dunes National Park at the halfway mark on the trip, all the way into a different time zone three states over, once you curve around the bottom of Lake Michigan. An article in The Innovator, a Governor's State University school paper, read as follows. Anna and Robert Davidson, both 27 of South Hermosa in Chicago, left the hassles of the city, work, and school and headed for the Warren Dunes State Park in Michigan to take the kids on a last outing before the summer ended. They arrived at the dunes around 3:30 in the afternoon. Minutes later, everything changed. Michigan State Police received a call at the New Buffalo Post at 6:35 p.m. from a concession stand worker. Visitors that day would hear a broadcast over the park radio system asking them to look out for a little African-American girl, 6 years old, 3 foot 11 inches, 61 pounds, wearing a white blouse, blue shorts, and white plastic shoes. Her name was Cathy Davidson. Cathy's parents said that when they arrived, they parked a car on the roadway overlooking the lake, and the children dashed out of the car and headed toward the creek that emptied into Lake Michigan to play. They said this happened around 4:00. The parents set up their picnic lunch and then called the children back to eat. They said all of the children returned except Cathy. So the family began to look for her but couldn't find her, even after they approached the concession stand and asked them to put out a broadcast over the public address system. The trooper didn't question the parents any further at that time because the primary concern was organizing the search as quickly as possible. This search would last a period of days and balloon in size and scope. The Michigan State Police summoned officers from the Buffalo, Benton Harbor, and Niles posts, as well as a helicopter from the Grand Haven post. Berrien County Sheriff's Department officers and Emergency Patrol assisted, along with the Chickaming Township PD, Bridgman PD, Three Oaks, Weesaw Township, and a number of off-duty police officers from Berrien and Indian counties. Lake Township, Lakeside, New Troy, Riverside, and Sawyer Fire Departments all assisted, in addition to civilian groups including the Civil Air Patrol and concerned CB radio groups from as far away as Detroit, Northern Ohio, Indiana, and Illinois. American Red Cross volunteers, as well as park rangers and campers from Warren Dunes State Park, also helped look for the little girl. Around 150 searchers had descended on the area very shortly after the initial call was made, and by 9 p.m. that night, there were between 300 and 400 people searching the area, all in an organized grid pattern from shore to highway and from miles north and south of the park itself. By 1:30 a.m. that first night, the entire area had been gone over. By the 4th, 3 days later, while the search continued, the outlook was bleak. No sign of the little girl other than a pair of underwear found in the area that her parents couldn't even identify as hers. Now before we get any further, let me see if I can help by describing the area to you. Warren Dunes State Park is made up of 1,952 acres along the shore of Lake Michigan. There's miles of shoreline and hiking trails and a camping area, a beach, natural dunes, a parking area, and in the very southern end of the park, where the Davidsons were that day, Painterville Creek empties into Lake Michigan, right near where the property ends and the residential area begins. The family was essentially picnicking in the southernmost area of the park, right at the edge of the park, before the residential area begins. From the very first minutes and then for days, while the search continued, officers began questioning people in the park, on the beach, and then the residents in the homes in the surrounding area. The beach itself had been full of people the day that Cathy went missing. Numerous people stated that no 6-year-old African-American girl had even been seen on that southern area of the beach in the park where her parents insisted that she and her siblings had run down to play. Because of the possibility that the little girl had somehow been grabbed and shuttled off the property by a stranger in a car, the following days were spent investigating every known pedophile and sex offender in the area, as well as every house nearby, in case she'd been taken inside. Nearby homeowners allowed their houses and properties to be searched. As tips flowed in about every weirdo in the tri-state area, police followed up on each one, leaning on their law enforcement partners to interview them until each one could be ruled out. Everyone who looked even remotely sketchy on the beach that day was checked into. It was repeatedly pointed out by beachgoers that a white man absconding with a little black girl wouldn't have gone unnoticed, but police still looked into every lead, however tenuous the threads might have been, and men in particular of all races were looked into with a very suspicious eye. Days later, police were still coming up empty. They had nothing. Not a single person on the beach, with the exception of her own family members, even saw the little girl. After the 4th of September, the search was called off. A local news article reported that the area had been searched 4 or 5 times, and any further searches would be of no value. It was now time for the police to circle inward and further question the family to see if there was anything else that they could glean that might lead them in the right direction. After all, it was 4 days after the little girl went missing, and they still had not interviewed Cathy's siblings, who were there with her that day, playing right in the area with her, some of whom were teenagers and surely had pertinent information. The children had been sent back to Chicago while Robert and Anna remained. Officers contacted them and several friends of theirs in the parking lot of the administration building of Warren Dunes State Park around 7 p.m. on the evening of the 4th. At that time, Mr. Davidson had a list of places that he wanted the police to search, including the sewers and storm drains at the beach house area, as well as the private house just to the south of the park near where they said they had been picnicking. He also told them to ask a camper named Debbie about a little girl that she had seen, matching the description of Cathy. The officer informed the group that they had already talked to this family, the Washingtons, and that the clothing description that they'd given did not match the description of the clothing that the family had given them. A friend of the Davidsons who'd been standing in the group and listening suddenly got angry and said, "Aw, man, they got to her." Then he threw his hat on the ground and stormed away. At this point, the officers mentioned that they had learned that Anna wasn't Kathy's biological mother and that they wanted to speak to her. Robert Davidson turned to motion to a woman standing nearby. He introduced them to Portia Davidson, his ex-wife. But he said he didn't want to answer any questions about his past, and he instructed the police not to question his ex-wife about his past because it had nothing to do with Cathy going missing. He said their job was to find his child, and that's all he wanted them to do. The officers wondered aloud if there might be an enemy or someone from his past that could have a motive in this case. To this question, Robert Davidson laughed, and then he insisted that it was nothing from his past. Doing their best to keep the lines of communication open, the officers backed off the touchy subject and asked the Davidsons about Cathy. Her parents said Cathy was a bright and intelligent child. She was familiar with the park and the area where they set up their picnic because it was a favorite spot of theirs. Because they didn't find her shoes, the officer asked if she would have taken them off to go into the water. At first they agreed that she would have taken them off, but then they said maybe she would have worn them in the water. Anna Davidson was then asked about the pair of underwear that the searchers found. She said Cathy had dressed herself, so she wasn't sure if they were hers or not, but they did look like a pair that belonged to Cathy. The officer then directed some questions to Portia Davidson, Kathy's mother, in an attempt to get her into the conversation. But Robert and Anna kept interrupting the questions and answering for her, so she ended up staying quiet in the background and observing. In his notes, the officer describes Anna as cool in the beginning of the interview, but later she sat down in the open car and rocked back and forth. He noted, however, that she did not cry. Because there was a group around them this entire time, the three-way conversations were impeding the officer's ability to perform a proper interview, so he invited the Davidsons back to the post for a proper interview the following morning. Unfortunately, this would become a pattern in the ensuing days. Every time police tried to question the parents, a group of people would be there, injecting themselves into the interviews, making it impossible for the police to get the information they needed. Portia Davidson, Kathy's mother, showed up at the post the next evening as requested. Robert and Anna never showed up. When they were asked why, Robert said they were too busy at the park. This bothered the police, so they asked Portia about her ex-husband. Was there anything that they needed to be concerned about? She said he did have a record of violence, but she didn't believe that he would hurt his daughter. Later that day, one of the local township police chiefs had come to the state police post with some information that he felt was relevant. He said that he'd arrived on scene at 6:30 p.m. on day 2 and assisted with the search throughout the night. He related how different groups involving hundreds of searchers went through the park, but it's what he saw the parents themselves doing, or rather not doing, that concerned him. He noticed Anna and Robert Davidson around 2 or 3 in the morning sitting in a brown station wagon with a white couple. They were all laughing and drinking beer. They had an alcohol bottle in the car too, which he thought was whiskey, but he couldn't say for sure. He said they didn't appear to be grieving parents. The incident that he saw occurred by the registration building, and he'd been parked about 30 feet away. He couldn't hear what they were saying, but described them as yakking and popping cans until 5:30 in the morning. He didn't see how the white couple left the area, but Anna and Robert were sleeping in the station wagon alone the next morning. His main beef, though, wasn't really the drinking. What bothered him was that none of these people, not the Davidsons or their friends, had assisted with the search that evening. 2 days after the initial request, Robert and Anna still had not come down to the police post for the requested interview. However, Mr. Robert Dunn, who was the Illinois State House representative in their congressional district, sure did. Apparently, he had received a complaint regarding the lack of effort and police cooperation in the search. I can picture this interaction, and so can you if you close your eyes. A politician and a law enforcement officer facing off across a desk. Both men with their respective jobs to do. Both concerned with public perception related to how they do those jobs. Mr. Dunn was patiently advised of the laundry list of resources that had been utilized for Kathy's search and investigation. Apparently, he left satisfied, but before he did, he offered his assistance, if needed, and the police took him up on it. They took that opportunity to mention the difficulties that they'd had in getting the Davidsons into the office for an interview. Representative Dunn said he would be happy to talk to Mr. Davidson. Later that very same day, the representative called and advised that Mr. Davidson would cooperate, but he didn't want to leave the park, where he was surrounded by friends, which was kind of the problem in the first place. So that really wasn't much help to the police, but during this call, they asked the representative for assistance in locating information from the Chicago area regarding the Davidsons' divorce and their past. They needed some ears on the ground. Robert Davidson's mother called back later in the day to pass along some information. This grandparent tried to paint Portia as uninterested in her children, other than she was, quote, in it for the money. But at this point, having been given an opening to again interview Robert, they contacted him at the trailer where he and Anna were now living at the main gate of the parking area. Somehow they had managed to get their hands on a travel trailer and were living on the park property. During this interview at the trailer, Robert proceeded to parrot the talking points that the previous caller had mentioned, noting that Portia was not a responsible person and had no concern for their children. Interestingly, he followed these accusations up by saying that there was no hard feelings with his ex-wife and he didn't think the child would be with her now or even with her mother. He said they all got along, but he hadn't seen her for some time prior to this. He noted that Portia had an older son by a previous marriage, in addition to Cathy and her sister, who was 3 years older than her. When pressed, the only incident from his past where Robert said he could have made an enemy was around 1969 while he was in prison. In his words, from the report, quote, he had a run-in with a homo and thinks this subject is now in New Orleans. He stated this subject wouldn't know where he lives or anything and discounted the incident. When the officer asked the name of this prisoner so that police could check into it, Robert Davidson couldn't come up with a name. Mr. Davidson then said he was not involved in any street gangs or gang activity because, quote, he gets along good with the gangs and is respected by them because he's an ex-con and he works with them. Robert was then asked to recount the people he recalled seeing at the beach that day when Cathy went missing. He said he didn't see any black folks on the beach during the time Cathy was missed, but he did remember seeing a heavy-built black woman and child around 9 years old the next day walking on the beach. Officers asked him who was the young white couple he and Anna were sitting in the car with in the early hours the night after Cathy went missing. He said that he didn't know who they were just a teenage couple that had sympathized with them. At this point, Robert defensively circled back to Portia, saying that when Cathy was born, Portia had filed for divorce. The officer patiently redirected him back to the day Cathy went missing. What they needed from him, they said, was to tell them what happened that day, starting with a ride over from Chicago. Robert said their picnic plans were spur of the moment, and they'd driven to the park in three cars. He said Cathy, Anna, and himself had come in the green Torino. A young family friend who had once lived with them drove the reddish-orange Ford, and Marvin Bobo, Anna's brother, drove the small Renault. He didn't know for sure who was in the other cars, but he did give a list of the other children's names. All he could remember from that day was that the children got out of the car and went down to play by the small creek while they set up lunch. He said he did observe people in the area, but he really wasn't paying attention and he couldn't describe anyone. On the same day, Portia Davidson was interviewed as well, but she spoke to the police at the station. She said that Kathy's sister lived with her and Cathy was currently with her father for the summer. He did have both children for 2 years, but Kathy's sister came back to live with Portia around Christmas time. She said Robert was abusive in his manners and conversations relating to her, their mother, and that the children really didn't like that. According to her, it wasn't physical abuse, just the way he talked, so that's why Kathy's sister wanted to return home to Portia. She said that Robert got angry when her daughter wanted to come back to live with her, and when he dropped her off at the house, he told his daughter that she'd never see Cathy again. This had all been relayed by Cathy's sister to Portia at the time. Portia advised that Cathy was his favorite, and he loved her very much. She said that he had a record of violence, but that Robert would never hurt Cathy intentionally. She was sure of it. She said that he had only married Anna last year, and she seemed to be a nice lady and took care of the children. She had several children from a previous marriage. She said that Robert had a police record since his teenage years, but no enemies that she knew of. She didn't believe that he was in any gangs or groups, but she did wonder about some of the children that Robert worked with, although she didn't think Cathy or the family were exposed to any of the students at his school. When the officer asked her point blank if she had taken Cathy, she said no, of course she didn't have her own child snatched to get back at her ex-husband. She gave birth to that child and she'd go through legal proceedings to get her back. She'd been trying to get full custody, but her attorney had died in a plane crash, and she had just gotten another attorney to look into the matter for her. When asked how the little girl would react around water, Portia said Cathy was not the type to wander off. She did like the water once she got used to it, but to get her in, you had to take her by her little hand and lead her in. She didn't think that she'd just go in the water by herself. Portia couldn't think of anything in the past that would be a motive or come up with any idea about where Cathy might be. "I don't want to think about it," she said. And the officer asked her what she meant by that. She said some weirdo might have taken her daughter and assaulted her, and she couldn't bear to think about it in that way. There was something that made her suspicious of Robert, though. Portia thought it was strange that he didn't seem too sure of who went and got the children for the picnic on the day in question. When they had talked, all of them in the group that day, about how the children were called back to eat, she said, Robert seemed like he wanted to say who went and got the children, and then he looked like he was going to change the names he had mentioned, and then he appeared to be unsure who went for Cathy. He had to look at Anna for a response to that question, so Anna gave one of the names of the kids. Portia felt that Robert should know who went and got who, and that exchange bothered her. Police asked her how she learned of Kathy's disappearance, and Portia said, Robert just came to her mother's house, walked right in, and said that Cathy was missing, real rough, and got her mother all upset. She felt that he could have been nicer when he broke the news. He wouldn't say what happened, just that Cathy was missing. After that, she tried calling the police post to get information, and she kept getting a weather report because she couldn't figure out the right area code, since this had happened in another state. She tried all night, and eventually she got a hold of Sergeant Snyder early Tuesday morning and learned that there were no new developments. But Robert wasn't sharing much with her. On this same day, after talking to Robert and then Portia, police interviewed Debbie back at the Warren Dunes campground. Now, Debbie was the woman who had allegedly sighted a little black girl the day Cathy went missing, the one that Robert Davidson wanted them to speak to. Yes, this is that same Debbie that when they were told the clothing description didn't match, his friend said the cops had somehow gotten to her. But police had already spoken to her a couple times. This would be their third interview. Debbie said that around 7 p.m. she was standing by the entrance to the women's restroom at campground number 3, which was across the park from where the Davidsons had been. And she observed a small black female child standing in front of the bathroom door. She asked the child if she wanted to go inside, but received no response. So she opened the door and the little child went in. Debbie then left the area and did not see where the child went after that. She gave the following description: a small black girl, approximately 4 foot tall, about 6 years old, wearing a white top and blue shorts, with her hair in braids. She told the trooper that she'd seen the picture of the missing child and that it was the same girl she'd seen in the restroom. She said she was positive she remembered her face. Debbie said that at the time she saw the girl, she didn't even know there was a girl missing. She learned about it around 8:30 that night. It was at that point that she contacted the park rangers and they quickly left to look around the restroom area. A short time after that, two men in plain clothes contacted her. They talked with Debbie and wrote down some information. She thought they were police officers because they had a radio in the car and lights in the back window. However, they did not identify themselves as police officers. Debbie said that she and her friend searched the park for the missing girl during the night, and around 6 or 6:30 in the morning, they were walking in the dunes and heard a voice from the top of the dune say, "I'm up here." When they ran to the top of the dune, no one was there. She thought someone might have been playing a joke on them. Debbie said she spoke to another black family that weekend who had camped near the restrooms, and they told her that they had not seen the missing child. Debbie said she saw the children inside their car and none of them looked like the girl that she had seen at the restroom. The trooper who took this interview noted that it took place at her campsite in his patrol vehicle, but during the entire interview, there was a group of 6 to 8 black males around the vehicle interrupting his conversation with Debbie with their own questions and making comments about the interview in the background. Also, two black males had tape recorders and were taping the interview, sticking their microphones through the open car windows. Robert Davidson was present during this interview as well. The officer said Debbie appeared nervous and uneasy the entire time. When the trooper drove her to the restroom for further questioning about where the incident had occurred, the group of black males followed them. While there, another black male questioned her, stating that he was from Operation Stick. He said they were trying to show malfeasance of duty on the part of the state police and park rangers. He insisted that not enough was being done because the little girl was black. This same man who stated he was from Operation Stick asked the trooper to identify himself and his badge number and insisted that he state his name into the tape recorder. He repeated that police were not doing enough to search for the little girl because she was black, and the police report notes that he was actively trying to get Debbie to say that no one had been interested in her story about the little girl that she saw. He was doing all of this and recording it during Debbie's police interview. A friend of Debbie's was interviewed at this time who said that he saw the girl near the entrance to the bathroom as well, and he saw Debbie open the door. In his version, he and Debbie had been searching the dunes and they were calling out Kathy's name and heard a voice from the top of the dune say, "Mama," but when they reached the top of the dune, there was nobody there. After this strange interview, to follow up on this witness statement, the troopers called in the two rangers from Warren Dunes to ask them about the initial tip that they had received from Debbie, the very first one. They said that they contacted her on the evening of the 1st at her campsite, the same day Kathy went missing. They interviewed her and several friends. Debbie stated that she had seen a small black child at the restroom and then identified the picture of the missing victim. She told the rangers that she thought the little girl was about 3, but gave a different clothing description than that of the missing victim given by her parents. The rangers then located the only black family in the campground and learned that they had 2 small black female children, who they had let go to the bathroom by themselves, without their parents, while at the park. The rangers believed that the child seen by Debbie was one of those children. These were the Washington girls. By the 8th, the newspaper was reporting that Anna and Robert had, quote, abandoned their work and studies and taken up residence in a house trailer in a desperate attempt to find their young daughter. Robert and his wife, Anna, both 27, have set up the small rented house trailer near the entrance to the lakefront park, where they plan to continue their search for their 6-year-old daughter, Catherine. I plan to remain here until I find my daughter, Davidson said in the article, which also noted that he took leave from his job as a social worker with the Chicago Association of Retarded Children at 153 West Garfield. Even then, according to this newspaper report, although the search parties had dwindled steadily, 7 volunteers, a handful of policemen, and a state helicopter were still at work. This same article said, quote, the rented trailer is costing $28 a day, and the Davidsons, who were enrolled at Governor State University in Park Forest, have suspended their educational plans until the search is over. I can't think about my job or school until I find her, said Davidson. In between all this back and forth with the sightings of the Washington girl, police were still getting tips regarding other children in the area who were missing, which they had to cross-check against, as well as tips about suspicious males in the area. Whether they were random males driving around or already known to police, they paid every one of them a visit and checked all their alibis for the time Kathy went missing. The chief of the township police was again interviewed because the previous night he had encountered a group of 20 to 30 black searchers on Tower Hill Road in the residential area just south of Warren Dunes Park. They were walking down the middle of the road chanting, holding sticks and clubs, and wouldn't give way to his police car. He stopped them and gave them a warning. About 15 minutes later, he observed another group of about 15 exit the area and enter the park. A short time after that, he observed yet another crowd, so he stopped to ask them what group they were affiliated with. No one in the group would answer. They just stood and stared at him. He drove off, and a short time later, yet another group was observed. When asked what group they were with, they also would not answer. He circled back to the previous larger group, and someone in the crowd yelled, quote, we are the grass, or ass in parentheses, the report says, eliminators. Another male in the group yelled, we're the honky eliminators. At this point, an older man in the group told the younger searchers to shut their fucking mouths. Meanwhile, on the 10th, Anna, who had still not gone into the post for a formal interview, called saying that she wanted to see an officer because she had some information. Both she and Robert, who was also going by David Davidson for some unknown reason, were met at the trailer home at Warren Dunes State Park. They said that about 3 weeks prior, a friend of their son was outside their residence in Chicago when a black male walked up to him and asked if he lived in that house, and he pointed to the Davidson residence. The friend replied no. The black male asked if a David lived there, to which the boy said yes, and he was told to go into the house and get him and tell him to go to Sue's house where she would talk to him. Apparently some of the family members called Robert Davidson David Davidson. You'll learn in future episodes that these two have a way of changing names a lot. So anyway, the Davidsons say they walk outside and nobody was there. Robert, aka David, said he didn't even know anyone by the name of Sue. Then the Davidsons fell back into their normal redirection, changing the subject to Kathy's mother, Portia, again. Robert said his mother had called and that Portia had been taking up a collection in the Chicago area for a missing child, and Anna said this could be verified by calling someone at the Fellowship Baptist Church. The Davidsons said that Portia's sister was telling people in various bars that Anna and Robert never brought Cathy to Warren Dunes Park, but did something to her before they arrived there. They felt the police should check this information out. While the officer was taking this down, a man named Robert Blue was also taking notes and asking questions. He said that he was the news editor for the student publication at Governor State University, and that there were, quote, heavy emotions at the university and in the Chicago area concerning the missing girl, as information was rumored that police were not following up additional leads. Mr. Blue was told that all leads were being checked out completely, but very few tips had been received that went directly to Cathy going missing. He was further advised that the entire park had been searched completely, to which Mr. Blue replied, "That's impossible. The park is too large." The trooper repeated himself. The park was completely covered by searchers, more than once. Mr. Blue said he had the names of two eyewitnesses who told him that they'd seen Cathy since she turned up missing and positively identified her picture. He asked the trooper why they hadn't been interviewed. The trooper asked for the names and addresses of these witnesses so it could be determined if they had in fact been questioned, to which Mr. Blue replied, I left that information back at the university. Blue was advised to contact the post with the information as soon as possible. Nowhere in the report does it note that Mr. Blue ever called police with any information regarding these alleged witnesses or ever made contact with them again. I did a little digging and found an article by Mr. Blue in The Innovator, the school paper. I'd like to read it to you. It's titled, "Where is Cathy?"
Abducted or missing? I put this question to one of the Michigan State Police investigating the disappearance of Cathy Davidson in the Warren Dunes State Park since September 1st, 1973. He replied, "I don't know. I don't know if she's lost or if someone took her from the park." The answer to this question, as of this writing, is still a mystery to the Michigan State Police, the FBI, and this particular trooper. The fact that there are over 2 miles of highway and hills between where Kathy's father last saw her and where two eyewitnesses first saw and let Cathy into a woman's bathroom did not seem to strike this trooper as being reasonable grounds to suspect abduction. In this particular area of the state park where the family stopped, there is also a small stream, not deep enough for a 6-year-old to drown in. However, it runs through the wooded area surrounding the beach, and the trooper thought it would be a waste of time following it for possible clues of Cathy's disappearance. "There is no way a 6-year-old could have climbed up all those hills all by herself," he said. The attitude of the officials in Michigan conducting the investigations from their office is summed up as follows. "All leads have been completely checked out, and that is all they can do. Yet a little black child just vanished into thin air 15 minutes after she entered the state park. Why did these officials call off the search only 24 hours after Cathy disappeared? Trying to write the story about Cathy and not feel that if it had been a white child lost, the investigation would have been conducted differently is very hard to do. The area adjacent to the state park is like a page out of a resort magazine. In fact, it's just that. With summer and permanent homes in the too much for most black folks to afford income bracket. Many of the white residents in the area have shown much concern for the welfare of Cathy. In fact, it was a white person who contacted a relative of the family immediately after hearing Cathy was missing. This makes the suspicion of abduction more than just suspicion. The eyewitness identified Cathy before she even saw the picture of her, and she felt that someone must have brought Cathy from the highway to the woman's washroom. Cathy may be found tomorrow, or she may be lost forever in yesterday, depending on what the authorities do to find her today. If what they have thus far is any indication of maximum effort on their part, they indeed have done all they can. Out of this whole affair, one single fact stands stripped naked of all pretense of things are getting better for black and poor people in this country. If you don't have a lot of money when you get into trouble and need help, don't call the authorities, call your friends. To all black people in particular who answered the brother's call with money or sympathy, right on for the darkness.
That last bit, right on for the darkness, it was in all caps. Listen. In this article, the author, Mr. Blue, made many statements that were factually inaccurate and posed them as fact to the reader. Mr. Blue said police called the search off after 24 hours. That's false, and if he'd been following the articles of his local journalistic brethren, he'd have known better. A great deal of time and resources went into searching for Cathy Davidson, almost all of which didn't include help from her own family. This writer misrepresented the sighting that police had already ruled as erroneous through thorough investigation. The writer suggested that the trooper thought it would be a waste of time to follow the stream through the wooded area for clues when, in fact, that whole area was grid searched on day one, and then more than once. And you know, his whole waxing poetic about the area Cathy went missing from being, quote, the too much for most black folks to afford income bracket, fell right in line with the rhetoric that Mr. Davidson himself and the group that had flooded the area in support of him, walking the streets with sticks and bats, were cultivating.
If people are trying to direct you off in different directions, it kind of sends up a red flag on that, especially if they're not being very cooperative.
Cathy wasn't being found because she was black. That's the narrative that they were pushing. Nothing could have been further from the truth.
They were sitting in a car with another couple drinking and laughing, and that doesn't sound like a distraught parent to me, especially on the very first night that your child's gone missing.
But this would not be learned for decades. In fact, Cathy wasn't going to be found. She's still missing today.
Can you just tell us where she is so we can recover her and give her the proper burial that she deserves?
That little girl not being found had absolutely nothing to do with the color of her skin.
The kids had to have seen a lot more than what they're telling.
You know, there's a history of this too, way prior to what happened in Micanopy, going back into the 70s in Chicago. And that's what's coming next, and that's something we came here to talk to you about too. For Cathy Davidson, that matter is being pursued by the Michigan State Police, the Chicago Police Department, and the FBI. They interviewed your mother two weeks ago, asked her about that, and the FBI offered us this opportunity. And this is a Joy suggestion, by the way. She said, if any of my brothers or sisters has a heart
to tell the truth,
to tell you what really happened, what they know.
Secrets and shame. It's a nasty combination.
Former cult leader with a history of torturing children has been living in Marietta for years now. Police say 75-year-old Anna Elizabeth Young used to live in Florida, where she ran a religious boarding school. But new information tonight connects her to a cold case involving the death of a child.
That little girl, the first little girl, who I would eventually learn wasn't the first at all, her name is Cathy. And I'm not sure she ever had a chance. She was failed by the people closest to her, who had it within their power, who have it within their power still, to raise their voices for her. Instead, their silence conveys one fact. To them, Cathy was disposable. By September 11th, 10 days after Cathy went missing, neither Robert or Anna had come down to the police station to give a formal interview. Meaning, while not surrounded by onlookers who continued to put in their two cents and toss barbs at police while the investigators tried to question them in a serious and undisturbed manner. The two had also not made their other children available for questioning, despite many requests, which seemed odd since most of those children were of an age that would have been old enough to give pertinent information about what actually happened. After all, according to their parents' story, these siblings had been the last people with Cathy, down by the water near the creek, all playing together. Around this time, park rangers also relayed to police that the behind-the-scenes talk from people that had been searching felt that they'd been misled by the Davidsons. They said that they were led to believe that Cathy was the only child of a young college couple. Folks started to wonder why none of the other kids who were supposed to be right there with Cathy at the time she went missing had any more information. Something didn't feel right. And then there was a prank call. Portia Davidson was working at the El Matador Cocktail Lounge in Chicago when the call came in. It was answered by a regular bar patron who handed her the phone. When she grabbed the receiver and said yes, the party calling did not identify himself, but he made this statement.
They found a little girl's body in the lagoon. How soon can you get here?
Portia said that she knew immediately it was the voice of her ex-husband, Robert Davidson. She went into a state of shock and dropped the receiver. The bar patron picked it up and began talking with the caller. Portia left immediately and went straight to the police post. She arrived around 9 p.m. She knew her ex-husband's voice and was almost certain that it was Robert Davidson behind the call. What happened next was one of those moments. You know, the kind where you wish you could be a fly on the wall. Officers accompanied Portia over to the camper trailer the Davidsons were living in. She walked right up to Robert and asked him why he'd called her. "I never called you," he yelled. Police outlined what had occurred regarding the call, and his response was, "That information was on some news story from Chicago at noon." A crowd began to gather at the trailer as Robert continued to yell and grumbled about how he knew the FBI had his phone tapped. "So why don't they look into tracing the prank call?" he said. Angrily, he wondered aloud why so many police were assigned to investigate a prank call when none of them were searching. Now, he knew full well the search had been done repeatedly. Surely he could see it happening around him. Police couldn't just keep searching and clogging up resources on things that had already been covered. They really didn't have anything but suspicious behavior on the part of the parents. Well, accompanied by exactly zero evidence to suggest that Cathy Davidson was ever at Warren Dunes State Park that day. Nobody saw her there but family members. The next time police approached Mr. Davidson at the trailer, he had several tape recorders running and a photographer taking pictures. He demanded to know about the tip regarding a white man on the beach with a black child. Police told him that the troopers had no idea where that rumor started, but it was just that, a rumor. They had no such report. Then Mr. Davidson started in on his usual routine about asking why the search wasn't still going on and what else was being done. Officers patiently answered all his questions. At the end of that chat, police calmly told them that they needed to interview the children. Mr. Davidson said if they wanted to talk to the kids, they could go to Chicago and do it because he didn't want to deal with the expense involved and bring the children back to the New Buffalo Post. Ironically, at this moment, to put a finer point on how full of shit Robert was about the search, a helicopter arrived to do another pass, so they were unable to continue their discussion due to the noise. Later that day, after the noisy helicopter had landed, Mr. Davidson grudgingly told police that the kids were en route to the park, and he demanded that officers be available to interview them when they arrived. Quite a few hours passed, though, much longer than it would have taken for the kids to get there, and Mr. Davidson called the police post after 7 p.m. that night and said that the children had finally arrived and they were ready for their interview. He was told by police that they needed to be interviewed at the police post, not at the park, because they wanted a quiet atmosphere with no distractions. Mr. Davidson said there were only friends at the park and it would be quiet. He said he was just too tired to bring the kids in, and then he demanded that the sergeant call him back, and he hung up. 5 minutes later, the state police post sergeant called Mr. Davidson back. He reiterated the importance of eyewitnesses being under the appropriate conditions necessary for an interview. And then the sergeant laid it right out, plain and simple. If you have any concern for your daughter at all, you will grant this simple request. Robert Davidson growled at the sergeant, saying that he'd been lied to again, and then he hung up the phone a second time. Now what happens next? I'm sure you'll be able to see it. The choreography here is blatant. The report notes that the sergeant was hung up on and then reads, quote, "A short time later, four black newspaper investigators arrived at the post. They advised that they are on the return trip from East Lansing headquarters and wanted the name and address of Portia Davidson. They were given the address and they requested to keep informed of any new developments. While they were there, the Davidsons, their friends, and their children all arrived. Then the Davidsons made a big deal of telling the newspapermen that they didn't want any police hassling their children. They requested that one of the three newspaper reporters, Floyd Rollins, Al Johnson, or Otis Shabazz from Muhammad Speaks newspaper, be present in the room while the children were interviewed. They also wanted the interviews taped. The officer granted the request, quote, because of the importance of the interviews. Mr. Rollins was the gentleman who sat in on the questioning of the children, and the officer noted that the following interviews were completed without incident. The interviews began at 7:42 in the evening. I don't think I have to explain to you why that might not be the most optimum time to be interviewing children. 15-year-old Anna's biological son from her first marriage was the first one to be interviewed. He said that he had traveled to the park in the orange car, and when they arrived, the first thing he did was run down the hill and sit on the sand and look at the water. He didn't know who was the last one to see Cathy, but they all went to look for her when she didn't respond to calls that supper was ready. He was sure that she didn't have any money on her, but she did like candy and knew where the candy stand was located at the park. He said that Cathy didn't bring any toys with her, and he didn't think there was any reason for her to return to the car. He said she was wearing a white top, blue shorts, and white shoes. He described that the picnic lunch was put out about halfway up the hill, but not close enough to see cars on the road. He said Kathy's hair was in French braids like the picture Anna had provided. He told them that Cathy did not know how to swim, but said she had been in the lake before and thinks that she would have taken her shoes off before going in. He didn't know if Cathy knew her way around the park, but he said that they had been there before, and in fact, they were there a couple days before Labor Day weekend. He personally felt that Cathy had been abducted. Next up was a 16-year-old girl who was one of Anna's stepchildren from an earlier marriage. She was not a blood relation. She said that she also came to the park in the orange car and that Cathy went in the green Torino with her parents. She said that they did not stop anywhere on the way from Chicago. She said when they arrived, she ran down the hill like the other children and then went to help set up the picnic lunch. She said the last time she saw Cathy was by the creek and that she did not have any toys or money with her. She described the picnic lunch being spread out on a blanket 7 or 8 feet up from the path. She described Cathy as wearing blue shorts, a white blouse, and white shoes, and her hair was in French braids like her mother. She believed that Cathy would have taken her shoes off if she went in the water, but she couldn't swim. When asked if she had anything else to add, she said that the white panties found by the searchers were just like hers, and they checked the house and Kathy's weren't there. Next up was Anna's biological daughter, also from her first marriage. She was 14 years old. She couldn't remember the color of the car she came in, but she said in the car with her was her brother and that 16-year-old non-relative family member, the stepchild of Anna's. She said they came directly from Chicago and did not stop anywhere. When they arrived, she said she took a bag out of the trunk. She said her little brother and Cathy had already gone down the hill to the beach. She didn't know who the last person to see Cathy was, but she thinks that her Uncle Marvin and her brother were the first to begin looking for Cathy when she didn't come back for supper. She said Cathy didn't bring any toys or money, and there was nothing that she'd go back to the car to get. She said Cathy was wearing sky blue shorts and a white blouse, and her hair was in French braids. She said that Cathy didn't swim and probably would not go in the water without somebody with her. She said Cathy does know the park and has climbed the hills and knows her way to the bathrooms. Next up was 12-year-old, another one of Anna's children from her first marriage. He said he came in the orange car that his brother was driving. He said Cathy was in the green car with her parents. He said he also ran down the hill when they arrived, but he didn't have any swimming trunks with him. He said he last saw Cathy by the sand at the creek. When they went to look for Cathy, his parents went to the concession area and the others went all around in different directions, asking questions of people on the beach. He said that Cathy was wearing a white blouse, blue shorts, and white sandals with her hair in braids. Police then spoke with little 6-year-old, who was the same age as Cathy at the time. He said that he went with his parents when they arrived and he didn't go with the rest to play in the sand. He said he last saw Cathy down by the water. He wasn't asked many of the other questions that the other children were asked, and mostly spoke with the officer about tunnels in the sand. They noted that nothing of value was provided. Next up was the 18-year-old who drove the other car. Their other sibling, who said he drove all the other children in his car, except Cathy and the 6-year-olds. He said they didn't stop anywhere on the way. He took the water cooler out of the trunk when they arrived. Everyone else had gone down the hill, and he walked down on the sidewalk toward the picnic area. He said the last time he saw Cathy was when he was getting out of the car. He said that when they realized Cathy was missing, they started to look around and ask people questions. He said Cathy was wearing a white shirt and blue shorts with her hair in French braids. He didn't think that she knew her way around the park and that she wouldn't go to the bathroom by herself. The last child to be questioned was a 17-year-old family friend who had stopped by their house on the spur of the moment that day, and so he drove his own car, a gold Renault. He insisted that they had stopped nowhere on the way. He drove his own car because he didn't want to get stuck at the park if he decided to leave before the rest. When they arrived, he helped get the food out of the car along with a couple of the other kids. He said he walked down to the bench picnic area via the stairs and last saw Cathy about 25 to 30 feet away from the creek. He said she didn't come to supper, and then everyone started looking for her. He noted that he and took the path around to the south and met Ranger Stilson and told him of the missing child. Around that time, they heard the announcement about Cathy over the loudspeaker. He said the picnic was set up about 12 feet up the side of the sandhill, and he described how they leaned different bottles and items against a big tree. He felt that they were sort of hidden in that spot, but they could see people around them. He said Cathy was wearing a white cotton blouse and white shoes, and she might not take them off to go in the water. He said that he never saw Cathy swim in the lake, but he had seen playing in the lake. He didn't know if Cathy knew the area, but she'd been to the park before. At the end, he added that a woman named Debbie had ID'd the picture of Cathy, and this was still on his mind. Robert and Anna expressed a desire to go through the list of questions that the officers had asked the children. So police took them through the same set of questions, and the answers that they provided are interesting. They did not feel that Cathy had any money on her, but they said that she did like candy. She did not bring any toys with her, and her favorite toy, a Raggedy Ann doll, was still at home. Police were asking that question, by the way, about the toys and the candy, to see if Cathy might have wandered back to the car to get anything, or up to the concession area to get candy. Presumably the idea would be if she'd done that, someone would have had easier access to snatch her, because it was near the parking area. Robert and Anna didn't remember any particular faces in the area, but they felt that if they saw pictures, it might come back to them. They said that Cathy knew her name and her address and phone number, and she was a good child. She had no problems in school. They estimated that about 5 other black people were in the park that day. They didn't know any of them. They said that the panties that were recovered by searchers were the same size and like the ones that they had bought. And then they checked at home and Cathy's weren't there. When they were asked if they stopped anywhere on the way, they said they stopped and bought some fried chicken at a place like Kentucky Fried Chicken, and then some other hot stuff at a small store on 159th Street before leaving Chicago for the park. They said they drove in the green Torino, and they had Arthur and Cathy with them, the two youngest, because those two play hard together, they said, and they could keep them apart. Anna then told the children that she wanted them all to tell the truth, and she hoped that they all had, because this officer was a good police officer. They all indicated that they had told the truth. Mr. Davidson said that he was beginning to accept the fact that Cathy was gone and something had happened to her. He said that they would be staying at the park for the weekend, but probably be returning to Chicago on Monday. So a couple things jumped out at me here. One question stood out like a sore thumb and suggested to me, among other things, that the children had been prepped. Robert and Anna, they messed up. There was one question that every child answered the exact same way, but the parents apparently didn't anticipate because they answered differently. Every one of the children said that they didn't stop anywhere on the way to Warren Dunes that day. Not one child answered otherwise. Not even the one who drove, the 18-year-old. While Robert and Anna said they stopped to get fried chicken and, quote, hot stuff on the way. Now, maybe they did. Or maybe they didn't. But wouldn't you expect at least one kid to remember either being schlepped into a KFC or some fried chicken place, as the Davidsons described it, or sitting impatiently in the car outside of said chicken place, anxiously awaiting the day's adventures at the dunes, while Mom and Dad grabbed lunch? I sure would. In the next episode, you'll hear my interview with Detective Douglas Kill with the Michigan State Police. Stay tuned.